Welcome to our Google Play Hangout on Air with New York Times bestselling author, screenwriter, and producer, Seth Grahame-Smith. My name is Oliver. I work on the Google Play team, and I'll be your moderator for this event. You probably know Seth as the writer behind Pride and Prejudice and Zombies and Abraham Lincoln Vampire Hunter, which combined have sold more than 1 million copies in over 20 languages. To get a flavor for his writing, here's the first line of the revised Jane Austen classic. It is a truth universally acknowledged that a zombie in possession of brains must be in want of more brains. And, of course, you know the rest. In 2010, Seth's tongue-in-cheek reimagining of history and literature continued with the book Abraham Lincoln Vampire Hunter, which he adapted into a movie that hits theaters next month. He also wrote the script for Tim Burton's Dark Shadows, starring Johnny Depp in theaters now. And finally, this prolific writer has just published Unholy Night, which is an action-packed retelling of the New Testament's three wise men of the Nativity. I've been having a lot of fun reading Seth's books on Google Play, and so without further ado, I'd like to welcome Seth Grahame-Smith to this Hangout and get this discussion started. Welcome, Seth.
Thank you. Nice to be here. Thanks for having me.
It's great to have you. Our first question comes from Edric. Edric, would you introduce yourself a little bit and then go ahead and ask your question?
All right. Hi, I'm Edric. I'm a senior studying anthropology at UC Irvine. After I graduate, I hope to pursue film. So my question for Seth regards the differences between the mediums of film and literature. From what I understand, it is much easier to adapt a short story than a novel because there's less of a chance you'll leave out important information due to film's time constraints. How did you choose what goes and what stays in the screenplay? And is your philosophy applicable to adaptations in general?
Well, it's a couple of good questions there. I mean, first of all, there are huge differences between writing a screenplay and writing a novel. I like them both, but they're very different disciplines. Writing a novel, you have more time to play around. You have a bigger canvas to play with. You can take your time sort of getting into characters' thoughts, into their heads, explore narrative, outshoots or outgrowths that don't necessarily have to resolve every time. A script, however, is, as you know, has to be tighter. Something that caps off at about 125 pages. Traditionally, most studios like that closer to 100 or 110 pages. So you really have to first and foremost know economy in your writing, and so anytime you're adapting a book, you inevitably end up making big cuts. And in the case of Lincoln, there were a lot of things we had to cut, but there are also things that we had to add. For instance, in the book, there's no central villain. There's no vampire bad guy twisting his mustache and laughing and saying exactly what we need him to say to sort of let us know what the vampires are up to. There's also no thrilling 3D action-packed climax either. So we had to invent some things. So adaptation is both of those things. It's about paring down sometimes, but it's also about building something new. And as to your point about short stories, a short story can be just as hard to adapt as a novel for that very reason, because you might find yourself with a nice, concise short story that might not be enough to feed a whole two-hour film. You might have to, invent a lot of new material for that. So, to me, there's no easy way of writing a screenplay. Scripts are a technical document. They have to hold up under intense scrutiny, and there's a lot of form that you have to follow. And so, basically, I don't know. I mean, it comes down to what you enjoy doing more as a writer. If you see yourself writing films, I enjoy writing books just a little bit more, just because you have so much more freedom. Just because it's a more pure way of communicating with a reader, whereas a script, like I said, is a technical document that has to communicate with a bunch of craftspeople and artists, all trying to get to the same story that's ultimately going to connect with an audience. So I hope that somewhat answered something that you asked. I'm not sure.
It did. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
And Seth, you've also been in this unique position where you've written you know, both the book, in this case, Abraham Lincoln, Vampire Hunter, and then adapted your own book to the movie. Was that difficult or challenging for you?
Sure. It's challenging to adapt any book, I think, into a movie that works. And we'll see whether or not it works. I mean, you guys will tell me about a month from now. But it's especially difficult, I think, for me it was, when it, being my own book, you have to get out of the way of your own ego just that much more. And you have to tell yourself to, all right, well, again, it's another reason I kind of prefer writing books, ultimately, is because when you're a novelist, you are the decision maker, the final say, basically, in what the story ends up being. In film, the final say goes to the director. And there are also, you know, 10, 20 other creative people collaborating with you on what goes into that movie. So it's a difficult process. But, yeah, I had to get out of the way of my own ego a lot when I was adapting Abe and sort of say, all right, I'm going to trust in the director.
Great. Our next question comes from Justin. And Justin, again, just introduce yourself and then go ahead and ask the question.
Hi, Seth. My name is Justin. I'm an information technology instructor in the United States Army and a big vampire movie fan. My question is, how did you come with the idea, or what was the inspiration to use a famous historical figure as a secret vampire hunter? Just how did you come about doing it?
Well, first of all, nice to meet you. And thanks for doing what you do. Actually, we're about to take the movie version of Abraham Lincoln Vampire Hunter onto an aircraft carrier in the Middle East, and we're going to show 2,000 sailors the movie on the USS Abraham Lincoln, which is crazy, and I can't wait to go to that. But to answer your question, the idea to combine Abraham Lincoln and vampires came out of just an observation. I was on a tour for my last book, before that, Pride and Prejudice and Zombies, and I would go to all these different bookstores all over the United States, and it seemed like, this was 2009, by the way, which was the bicentennial of Lincoln's book. But it seemed like no matter what bookstore I went into, no matter where I was in the country, there were always two displays right up in the front of the store. Number one, you had the Abraham Lincoln biography table of all those books, and number two, you had the Stephanie Meyer, Twilight, True Blood, Vampire, you know, table of all the vampire books that were especially popular in 2009. And so it was kind of just this bombardment of, like, Lincoln, vampires, vampires, Lincoln. And it started out by me saying, wow, man, if you could figure out a way to combine those two things, you'd really be onto something. And then that led me to research the real life story of Abraham Lincoln. And in researching his real life and reading about him and getting to know the real actual story, that's when I kind of got obsessed with it, and because his real life was, it didn't need vampires to make it bloody and tragic and interesting and badass, but you could see that adding that would just emphasize all the themes in his life that much more in an absurd way. That's what I do.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Great. Kim has the next question. Go ahead, Kim.
Hi, my name's Kim. I'm a 3D animator for a dredging company here in Illinois. I believe my question was already asked. I'm going to ask a different one. So you've covered zombies and you've covered vampires. Are you going to then maybe do werewolves or ghosts with George Washington or...
Yeah, I don't know. It's a tough one because, you know, the most success that I've had is with, you know, vampires and zombies. And so, like, again, it's naturally you want to follow and just say, all right, well, I got to do my werewolf book and keep this thing going. But to me, you know, what I grew up reading science fiction, fantasy, and horror books. And I grew up in my teens, you know, just being a huge worshiper of people, writers like Stephen King. And so, you know, I see myself sort of trying to grow as a novelist anyway into a space where I can tell good old-fashioned horror stories that don't necessarily have to be like historical figures meet this or this concept meets that concept and we mash them up. That might still happen in some ways. I can't, you know, I don't know for sure what the future holds, but I personally, I'm going to try to grow into doing those bigger, bolder whether they be sci-fi horror or fantasy horror or something horror, you know, horror comedy. I mean, something as long as it has horror in is what I'm getting at. You know, I'll be happy. But my question for you is, what does you said you work for a dredging company?
Yeah.
And so what does a 3D animator do for a dredging company?
I model their dredges, and they put my models in their GPS positioning programs, so the operator on the dredge can see my model digging in real time in relation to the surface or lake.
That's totally fascinating, and I did not know that existed, so now I know that. That's awesome. Thank you for the question.
Thank you.
Great question. Laura's next. Laura, go ahead and introduce yourself and then ask your question.
Hi, my name is Laura, and I'm a freelance graphic designer. My question is about the way that you had to write this one as compared to Pride and Prejudice and Zombies. How much research did you have to do this time around for the basic timeline and get your events in order because they're historical? And was it a lot harder to write for that reason?
Yeah, it was research intensive as much as I could cram into sort of a 3 or 4 month period before I started writing the book. I read some biographies about Lincoln. Fortunately, there's a vast amount of material available online. So being semi agoraphobe, not really, but just kind of a homebody, like. You can get online and this is when I actually spoke to Google employees at Google, the first thing I said to them was like, I could not write these books unless you existed, because I literally, I find myself throughout the writing of a book just Googling this and Googling that, and the challenge is you can't purely rely on what you find online unless you're able to corroborate it with, multiple sources. You have to be a little suspicious sometimes, but I did a tremendous amount of research. There's a site for Lincoln especially called the Lincoln Log that I used every day when I was writing the book. And it's someone has taken every day of Abraham Lincoln's life and sort of cataloged it. And you can click on, the third week of his 24th year and see, like, on that Tuesday afternoon, a check that he wrote or an IOU he wrote that someone has scanned and, like, put that. I mean, every single available resource. So what I did was I built a timeline for myself of Lincoln's actual life and filled in the things that were interesting to me that I read in all the biographies. And then I wove the thread of the genre story around that.
Thank you.
Cool. Thanks for that shout out for Google search, Seth.
I'm just pandering, but, it works.
All right. Bernard just joined us. Bernard, go ahead and introduce yourself a little bit and then ask your question.
Hello. Hi.
Hi, there you go.
I've actually just woken up because it's like 6:30 in the morning now in Hong Kong. I am a technical writer for a technology company. It's Hong Kong. It's like I've literally woken up about 5 minutes ago, so I'm sorry if I'm still a bit groggy.
No worries. It's nice to talk to you. Yeah.
It's good to be here. Can I actually add to the previous question first?
Sure.
You said like you did all this research on like Google and stuff, but was there any physical research that you could do? So like, I'm not sure about like going to the archives, but sometimes when you see movies, you see people going to the actual library or getting old documents and old text and sort of like researching like that. Did you do any kind of things like that?
Well, there was research in terms of the physical books that I read. That was really the majority of the physical research. I was under sort of a crazy deadline to deliver the book. And so, ideally what I would have done if I was smarter and had all the time and resources in the world is I would have gone. I live in Los Angeles. I would have gone to, Illinois, and I would have gone, walked, around Old Springfield, and I would have gone to Washington, D.C. and sat in Ford's Theater and just sort of absorbed those places. The physical books, books like Team of Rivals, books like Lincoln President-elect and Lincoln's melancholy and books that were very helpful in sort of forming the character portrait of him were the bulk of the physical research. Oddly, after I wrote the book, I have sort of struck up this friendship with the people who run the Presidential Museum and Library in Springfield, the Lincoln Presidential Museum and Library. So I've been there a couple times now and have gotten to go down into their temperature, humidity-controlled vaults and actually hold Lincoln's top hat and actually hold a handwritten copy of the Gettysburg Address and, you know, things that would have been great before I wrote the book, but I'm happy that they were able to write the book. Now, you know, but I do rely on, you know, sometimes literally if I'm just trying to get a mental image of something, I'll Google, do an image search for, you know, Springfield State House, or I'll do an image search for, you know, Ford Theater interior and be able to describe something accurately to the period, and that's very valuable. But with the new book, with Unholy Night, you know, you're writing about, you know, 1 AD, so it's a bit harder to, you know, get photos, period photos, and you have to sort of rely on, you know, your imagination a little more and pictures of ruins that still exist in you know, present-day Israel and elsewhere to inform what you're writing about. And there's artist renderings and things, but again, you know, physical research in terms of books, everything else in terms of Google searches and image searches.
And speaking of your new book, let's also talk a little bit about how your books have evolved. You know, you've written a lot of mashups. First came Pride and Prejudice and Zombies. Next, Abraham Lincoln, Vampire Hunter, and now Unholy Night, which is a retelling of the Nativity through sort of a retelling of the wise men tale. How do you see your work evolving, and you know where it's sort of come now?
Well, I think it's, you know, if you look at those three books, that there's this definite trajectory that I'm conscious of, which is the first one was basically grafting a story onto an existing book, the actual text of the book, you know, and there was a lot of, you know, what I call microsurgery to sort of weave the story in between the lines of that actual book. But I had a whole book to use as a crutch. In Lincoln, I didn't have a pre-existing book about Lincoln fighting vampires, but what I had was a pre-existing life that was extraordinarily well chronicled, and so the crutch, whenever I needed it narratively, was just go back to what is Lincoln doing at this moment in his life and then make that about vampires. And so with Unholy Night, essentially, you know, I'm focused in on a few specific lines of scripture, mostly from the Gospels of Matthew and Luke, and building out this story based on, you know, essentially a small amount of information. There's a lot of tradition around the Nativity story, but there's not a whole lot of scripture, oddly, and especially about, you know, where does Jesus go after Bethlehem, and how does he escape, and does he go to Egypt to hide from Herod, and how does he get there, and are there fights? And all. So that was, to me, further removing myself from having the crutch of existing narrative. I mean, as I go forward, you know, I'd like to continue doing that. Like I was saying a minute ago, I think, you know, I want to keep working and building towards maybe narratives that might have something completely weird and insane about them and very scary, hopefully, but are sort of freestanding structures.
Cool, thanks. We have time for more questions after the first round, so if you have another question, why don't you just raise your hand and then I'll call on you. Yes, go ahead. Go ahead, Kim.
I am a huge fan of Beetlejuice, and so I read somewhere that you might be writing the script for that.
Yeah,
really awesome.
Well, I hope it will be awesome. I mean, you know, just to clarify, like, yes, you know, so I have a company that we do film and television, and the company, we have a deal with Warner Brothers, and I, you know, have so far a very good relationship with Tim Burton, and so it just came about that, you know, for years people have been wondering, you know, was there anything else to do with Beetlejuice, and so Warner Brothers asked me and my producing partner David to sort of think about what that would do, and you know, so here's where we're at. I mean, basically, I've sat down with Tim about it, and we've said, you know, if we can come up with something really cool, maybe it would be great to come back to. I sat down with Michael Keaton, who, you know, makes no secret about the fact that he would love to play that character again, but only if the story is, you know, worthy. I mean, if we were doing this for my office, you would see behind me is an original 1988 Beetlejuice poster that I had framed because it's one of my favorite movies. And the last thing that I want to be remembered for is the guy that ruined the legacy of Beetlejuice by making a really bad sequel that nobody needed or asked for. And so, you know, my attitude is, right now I'm thinking about the story and you know, gestating and marinating and whatever you want to call it. And there's a goodwill towards it, but only if the story is something where we all read it and say, wow, that's really worth doing. The one thing I can tell you for sure is it will not be a remake. We're not remaking the original movie. It would actually be a sequel 26, 27, whatever years later, and with Michael Keaton back in the makeup again. But, you know, but that said, if it comes down to us just kind of having a lukewarm idea and doing it out of a sense of, you know, cynicism or greed, then I don't think anybody involved will do it for this reason.
Well, that's good to know.
So if you never hear of the Beetlejuice sequel again, it's because I wasn't smart enough to come up with a good idea.
The story wasn't good enough, huh?
Okay.
Great. We have time for probably one or two more questions. So yeah. Okay. Yes, go ahead. Laura.
Pride and Prejudice and Zombies is also a graphic novel, and I wondered how that process came about and how involved were you with that? Were you excited that that was happening?
That process came about because the publisher, Quirk, you know, realized that the book was, you know, such a huge hit that they'd be crazy not to put a graphic novel out. And so they partnered with a company that does exactly that, and sort of did it, I think, as a licensing thing. I love the graphic novel. I have many copies here in the office, but I had absolutely nothing to do with it other than having written the source material. That was some people that actually know how to make graphic novels.
Gotcha. Thank you.
Thanks. Any other questions? I have one. What was it like to work, or what has it been like to work with legendary duo of Tim Burton and Johnny Depp? How's that been?
Well, I mean, it was great. For me, it was a dream come true, literally. You know, growing up and admiring the not only the films that they had made together, but the films they made individually. And you know, I have very specific and crystallized memories of seeing Tim's films in the 80s, you know, Pee-wee and Beetlejuice and Batman and Edward and onward. And, you know, those were some of the seminal, like, career-shaping or goal-shaping films for me as a young person. So it's a crazy thing when you get to meet one of your idols, and even crazier when you find yourself to be very compatible. And that it's just been a great experience. You know, I'm working on some other things with him, and I'd love to work with Johnny again. I mean, Johnny is, you know, just one of a kind. He's a gentleman. He's an artist, and you know, both of them just could not be nicer, more supportive, collaborative, encouraging, all this stuff. So yeah, I mean that was, you know, for me, It, the whole Dark Shadows process was amazing.
Great. Any other questions, guys? Oh, Bernard, go ahead.
Can I just ask, like, as the writer of Dark Shadows, how involved were you in the whole sort of, you know, making the movie process? I mean, were you on set a lot, or on, like, advising with the script, or were you just sort of observing, like, from, you know, the Dark Shadows, as it were?
I was involved. I mean, in the writing process, it was primarily Tim and I sitting down a lot, but also Tim and Johnny and I sitting a lot and talking early on about what their tone was, what their take was, what their shape of the story would be, and I would take that back to my little lair, and I would write some things up and send it out to both of them, and they would give me feedback, and that went on and as I wrote the draft. And then when we were making the movie, I was fortunate enough to be there quite a bit. Sometimes I would go over and just sort of be on call if they thought that there was a sequence coming up that might need some retinkering. And sometimes I was brought back to, and we shot it in England, so I would go over when, you know, there was specific work to be done. I had an office there, but sometimes, you know, I just was lucky enough to sit and observe the process, which, you know, for me was just an invaluable lesson in how movies of that scope are put together.
So, was the original idea from... Sorry.
Oh, no, go ahead, Bernard.
I think I've got a bit of a slow connection here. But, you know, was the original idea from Tim Burton and Johnny Depp, or was it one of your original ideas that, you know, you took to them?
No, it was Dark Shadows in the U.S. In the 1960s was a quirky gothic soap opera that used to be on every day in the afternoons. And it ran for 4 or 5 years, I think 1,250 episodes, and then was canceled and subsequently sort of went away. And then there's been a resurgence of interest in the show. Over the years, there have been attempts to relaunch it as a dramatic series and things like that. But Tim and Johnny both remember being young and running home to watch it because it was so different, and they both loved it for those various reasons. And the central character, which Barnabas Collins, who Johnny plays in the movie, one of Johnny's childhood ambitions was to someday be able to play Barnabas Collins, and he was able to, you know, make that happen. So.
Okay, that's awesome.
Okay, so last question for you, Seth. You've written for novels, you've written for movies, TV, even comic books. So what's next? A rock opera about zombies?
I mean, you may ask it in jest, but I'll tell you what. It may not be that outside the realm of possibility, just because one of my weirdest jobs when I was, before anyone would buy or even read anything that I wrote, when I was out in Los Angeles just hacking away trying to become a working writer, I got to, I was hired by VH1 to write 12 songs for these sort of parody songs for this obscure reality series that starred Flavor Flav. So I do have songwriting credits, and you know, I think we should be bringing back musicals. I'm a fan of the musical, and so, you know, listen, like, it's entirely possible.
I'd love to see that. Well, great. That's all the time we have today. I want to thank Seth Grahame-Smith, the extremely creative author and screenwriter, for being our guest today on today's Google Play Hangout on Air. And thank you also, thank you also to his awesome fans. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Thank you, Seth.
Thank you. Thank you, guys.